from those backgrounds, we apologize. But yes, you're probably living in one of those countries if you're listening to this show, so it's relevant.
It's relevant to you right now. Definitely. So we usually start with a news article. Do we actually have one this week?
Well, because part of the show is going to revolve around a current news article, I was thinking we could actually kind of
start it off.
Well, save it, actually. Save it. Our news article is actually going to be our, like, amazing conclusion to the sexual history.
We're changing
of
it up.
Female sex drive.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So maybe we should start with some tunes, if I can get it set up here.
Yeah, let's start with tunes.
Tunes it is. I'll just...
Let's preface this with saying that Dandy here.
Dandy. That's me.
She searched for songs that were specific to the female sex drive, about the female sex drive.
Yes.
So these are all kind of, these all relate to the show.
Ooh, related songs, not just random sex songs. Yeah. As we usually play.
We do our back work. You know, like we.
That's so true.
Yeah.
So I.
Sometimes our research is quite fun, actually.
That's my favorite part of my job here. Yeah. So I'm going to start with a song called More, More, More by Andrea True Connection. It's an old disco song, but this is a remix by Federfunk. I can never pronounce things
Do you know when the song came out?
70s?
During the sexual revolution.
And woohoo! Party on. So I'm going to play the song and I'm going to explain why it's more relevant in detail shortly. So please enjoy. It's an old disco song. This is a remix by Federfunk. I can never pronounce things
Do you know when the song came out?
70s?
During the sexual revolution.
And woohoo! Party on.
What the heck just happened?
So I'm going to play the song.
What happened? What's going on?
We're listening to ourselves. Shortly, I know exactly what happened. I pushed up the remote instead of the aux.
Oh, wow. So weird.
That was trippy. Listening to us being recorded.
I thought we went back in time for a second. Oh my god, we're a time machine.
So this is the actual song, More, More, More.
Wait, tell us on Facebook how many of you thought they went back in time.
Oh, that's true. We'll be reading.
Thank you.
Wow, that was loud. Sorry. Didn't mean to yell at you. Hello, we're back.
We had a little powwow meeting.
We did. We actually have an actual book in the studio right now.
A really cool book, actually. I've used this book in like 3 different women's studies classes.
Wow.
It's very cool. It's called Petticoats and Prejudice, Women and Law in 19th Century Canada.
That's cool.
It's a great read. There's tons of really cool case stories about like these really powerful prostitutes that were like really rich off of running their own brothels, and
nice.
Really interesting marriage and rape laws and all sorts of stuff.
Yeah. So I'm going to explain the song that we were just listening to, and then we'll go into that book. So the song that we were just listening to, as I said, was called More, More, More. The reason why it's relevant to today's topic, as we mentioned earlier, this is the Naughty Hour. And we're talking today about women's sexuality, specifically the fact that they have one. So this song was by Andrea True, and she was actually a porn star back in 1975. And she was in Jamaica during a coup that was happening. And essentially what happened was she had no money left. So she decided that she was going to write and record a song. She invited a friend from a record company to come and write a song about sex and how she wants more, more, more. So that's why the song is relevant, because she's a porn star and, wow, has a sex drive.
And a good example of a porn star where it's not just like, oh, poor porn stars, they're victims of objectification. Like, true. Clearly she's like, yeah. Wrote a song about how much she loves sex. Let's put this into context.
Yeah, for sure, definitely. So what are we going to start with today?
Well, the interesting thing about the past and the present trend that's kind of phrase that's been talked about a lot is slut shaming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I don't know if you've ever heard of the term slut shaming for any listeners. It's basically like shaming a woman for being sexual,
yes.
For how she dresses or if she's promiscuous or how she talks about sex. This has been going around for centuries. Like, the term may be new, but it's very old.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be a lot worse, actually. So we're going to stick to like 19th century and 20th century, cool. Just so we don't get too crazy.
Definitely.
So way back in the 19th century, women were property of men.
Yes.
And there is this interesting, still present view sometimes actually, that of sexuality with the genders, that men couldn't help themselves. They had this like innate sex drive. They had to have sex, couldn't control themselves. It was a need. And women didn't have one. Women had no sex drive. The only purpose of a woman's sexual organs was reproduction and to serve the needs of men.
Yes.
In fact, women were viewed as like very pure and like asexual. Wow. So that, taking that into consideration, if a woman had sexual needs, she like basically lost her place as a woman. She was characterized as like less than a woman. A lot of like working class women kind of fell into that definition, because by default they were less women anyway, because they were working class. A lot of minorities, especially Native Americans and First Nations, mm-hmm. were automatically classified as sexual deviant just based on their race.
Wow.
So it was mostly middle and upper class women that had to kind of stick within this like pure confines, because their like status was at stake.
Definitely.
So a lot, this concept wasn't just a social concept, it was written into law. And there's several different laws surrounding it. One was the seduction law. So taking from the book I mentioned, there's some really interesting information. They actually have some really good like actual legal cases.
Wow.
Which I won't read, because there's like pages and pages of them. But there was a common law rule that allowed an employer to sue someone who had injured his or her servant. And this is also interesting because fathers had begun to use the action to avenge the seduction of their daughters.
Wow.
So if their daughter had sex before marriage,
yes,
the father could say, well, she's asexual. She doesn't have a sex drive. You seduced my daughter. I'm suing you for damaging my property.
Wow.
Again, this is like the woman, who cares what her needs or her, like, she doesn't get to sue.
No.
However, the cases were really tough, because you had to prove the moral character of your daughter.
Wow.
So she, like, you had to make sure she was, like, going to hold up to that. Because if she didn't, then what happened is she would be classified as a temptress, and the guy that slept with her could then sue the father because his property had tempted him and hurt his character.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, wow. That's like a siren-esque kind of... It's like, oh, I'm trying to coerce you into having sexual relations with me.
Yeah. So this whole idea of like women feeling repressed about their sexuality has like some pretty strong roots to it. Because if you stepped outside that bound of being pure and asexual, like your family reputation was at stake. You've damaged your father's property. You no longer get to be a woman.
There's something distinctly disturbing about a father owning his daughter's virginity.
Yeah,
a little bit. Like, why?
This is really gruesome. Like, it's almost incestuous in a creepy way. Right? Totally. Is that what you're getting at?
Wow.
Also, I was thinking too. Like, while a lot of these, because you don't really have records unless you can get a hold of some diaries, from like over 100 years ago.
Wow.
But like, I wonder how women felt during that day and age. Like, we already have a hard time. Like, oh, if I wear this shirt, are people going to think I'm a slut? Well, back then, if you look at a guy a wrong way, are you going to like ruin your family's reputation?
Definitely. So,
and also, you're taught constantly that you should not have sexual desire. Mm-hmm. So, but obviously women did, because there were lots of premarital sex and affairs and all sorts of things. So like, I wonder how you felt as a woman. Like, did you then be like, oh my gosh, I have sexual desires? Would there not be some guilt associated with that? Like, I must not be a real woman.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the history that I know a lot more about than, I mean, we're talking currently about the 19th century, if you're just tuning in, is the history that existed back when my parents were younger, right? In the 60s and 70s, what we're talking about, the sexual revolution, the concept of having sex and being actually able to have more sex because of the birth control pill, right? It was a big change in our society, and it continued to be a big change in our society. And women who were on the pill were automatically seen as slutty.
Oh, right.
Because they were able to have as much sex as they wanted to. And so guys would seek out specifically girls that were on the pill and therefore seen as liberal and free in that way. So, I mean, that's kind of interesting, the switch that it's gone from being really cool to be pure and then being really cool to not be pure. But even then, there still existed that subculture of shaming women into not being that person. Deep.
Yeah. And that you also have other women shaming women.
Definitely.
Because you're raised in an environment where you're like, no, only guys act like that.
Yeah.
Don't ruin our name as women by acting like a guy.
Definitely. I mean, it says something automatically that one of the biggest insults that you still hear in schools today is the word slut towards a girl, right? As opposed to any other thing that could be easily the same insult.
So going on a bit of a historical timeline here.
Ooh.
The interesting thing that came out of a lot of this like Victorian era purity idea, was that a lot of women didn't want to have sex as a result. You know, they're taught that they shouldn't want sex. Mm-hmm. And then their marriages are set up so that it's not about their needs. Yeah. A lot of people are in marriages they don't want to be in, that sort of thing. So in the, I think it was the 1930s. I wrote it down somewhere. Well, you should double check these.
Fact check.
This idea of frigidity came up, where if a woman didn't want to have sex, it was because she was frigid. And this was an actual scientific medical term.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the whole idea was that it had nothing to do with her environment, how she was raised, the state of her marriage, any of that. That there was now something wrong with her for not wanting to have sex, which is just this total, like, contradiction. Like, it's such a...
Yeah.
oxymoron. Like, oh, you're not supposed to have sex or want sex, or you're not supposed to want sex, but if you don't want sex, then there's something wrong with you. But if you do want sex, there's something wrong with you.
Yeah.
So have fun.
you need to be exactly in the middle. You need to be essentially a complete, pure, and wholesome, quote unquote. Not actually, I was doing air quotes. You can't see that on the radio. Wholesome individual. And as soon as you get married, you need to be like a dirty, dirty lady in bed and like it.
But only stuff your husband wants you to do.
Exactly.
Not stuff you want to do, because then you're a sexual deviant freak.
Yes, no, of course. And you can't even communicate that kind of stuff, right? Like, that's disturbing.
So that term frigid actually became like a big like gender slur, and now it's not recognized by the medical community at all.
That's good.
Yeah, there is a disorder for people who like do you have problems with arousal?
Well, I mean, the concept of asexuality is a big thing, and it still exists in our society. And I think I've been in relationships before where I just wasn't happy, and I remember getting insulted in the way of saying that you're asexual, right? And that's still a big thing. Like, automatically, there's something wrong with you if you don't feel like you are sexually satisfied.
So we actually have a funny article from The Onion about this. It's regarding, like, present day situation.
Definitely.
However, it definitely pertains to the earlier era when you're, you know, it's like the 1940s, 30s, and you're like exhausted and probably more so than today, and you don't want to have sex. Definitely. So this is a satire, though,
yes,
that illustrates the absurdity of expecting someone to be in a sexual mood.
Definitely.
Even though it takes place in a modern setting. I need my glasses. I can't read what's on the screen. I'm blind.
So, I'll just give a little preamble then. So this is an article from The Onion that was kind of viral this week.
That our good friend,
who is unfortunately not with us right now, Maxy Sariola, posted on her Facebook. So this one is called Nothing Gets Me Wetter Than a Monotonous Domestic Routine. It's Melanie Kayfetz.
Nothing gets me wetter.
Well, okay, good to know. I don't think that's true.
So she writes, "The libido is a mysterious animal. Everyone's tastes are different, and what excites one person might be a complete turnoff to another. I'd be hard-pressed to come up with my number one turn-on. There are so many things that can be arousing, from a romantic candlelit dinner to a kiss to a loving massage. But I guess I'd have to say that at the end of the day, nothing gets me wetter than the boundless monotony of the domestic grind. It's a slow build that starts in the morning. Just waking up on the same side of the bed that I've shared with my husband for 11 years sexually arouses me, but it's knowing that I have to hustle to drop the kids off at the bus by 7:30 and then pick them up after school on my way home from work every single day that gets my juices flowing. By the time I've mixed a half cup of wet dog food with a half cup of dry dog food and thrown my children's dirty clothing in the hamper, I'm good and slick. It's only when my husband grabs his keys from the bowl by the front door, gives me a perfunctionary peck on the cheek, and asks me if I can pick up his Lipitor prescription that my honeypot starts melting for real.
Ooh.
I don't know what it is about the ho-hum procession of daily errands and deeply ingrained domestic habits, but something about the way my husband and I go on autopilot for weeks at a time without ever being truly conscious of each other gets me soaking wet. I'm all flush right now just thinking about it. It's like he's hitting my G-spot every time he texts me at precisely 6:30 to ask what we're going to do about dinner. Just knowing that it's Monday and we always, always have spaghetti on Monday is enough to make me drip buckets. But when I'm waiting in line at the same CVS I go to about 8 different times a week, I practically have to clamp my hand over my mouth to stifle my moans as I buy milk and some poster board for one of my daughter's science projects." So it's actually quite long. I think we get the idea, right?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. 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 It's it gets a little bit risque near the end. Not that we haven't done this before, but it is quite funny.
Well, do you want to read like the last little bit there?
Sure.
This is, so now we're at the end of the day. It's about time to go to bed.
All right. Yes, yes, yes. I'm a naughty, little, nasty girl, and he's giving it to me exactly the way I need it. My God, does that deep, toe-curling climax rock me when he comes back to bed, plugs in his phone charger, and rolls over like he doesn't even aware that I'm alive. And if he checks his email one last time before he starts sawing logs, three words: shuddering, vaginal, orgasm. My pussy is just sloppy, throbbing mess right now. I guess it's the going through the motions, etched in stone aspect of it that really whips me up into a frenzy. Those identical humdrum nights, weeks, months, hell, years, all blurring together into the same endlessly repetitive pattern, like a long, expansive gray wall, over and over and over again. So much hotter than the old days, when we just... all the time. Beautiful.
Yeah.
So that is pretty funny. Obviously, again, as I said, it was an Onion article.
Satire.
Not real. But I'm sure, you know what, some people may enjoy that, the monotonous, which is not to say that it's not a bad thing. Obviously, we always say that's okay for everything. But it's kind of funny, because I think that we have all been, if we've been in a long-term relationship, and I think we've all done that, we just don't realize how slow and monotonous things get.
Or they can get.
Yeah,
you know?
For sure. Definitely.
And that you, especially before this current last couple decades, where like women were expected to always be domestic. You didn't really have a choice.
Mm-hmm, definitely. Now, speaking of that, I'm going to play another song for you. This song is actually, there's a radio edited version, but we're not going to play it because I find it really silly that it's an edited version of the song. But it's Britney Spears' If You Seek Amy, which was a song that came out about 4 or 5 years ago. Pretty funny song, so listen up. And again, this is the Naughty Hour on Trent Radio.
If you seek Amy.
Oh baby, baby, have you seen Amy tonight? Is she in the bathroom? Is she smoking up outside? Oh baby, baby, does she take a piece of lime for the drink that I'ma buy her? Do you know just what she likes? Oh, oh, tell me, have you seen her? Cause I'm so, oh, I can get her off of my brain. I just wanna go to the party, she gon' go. Can somebody take me home? Ha ha hee hee ha ha ho. That she's gonna meet me up. I don't know where or when, and now they're closing up the club. Oh, I've seen her once or twice before, she knows my face, but it's hard to see with all the people standing in the way. Oh, oh, tell me, have you seen her? Cause I'm so, oh, I can get her off of my brain. I just wanna go to the party, she gon' go. Can somebody take me home? Ha ha hee hee ha ha ho.
back. That was Britney Spears' If You Seek Amy. Really good song. As I said, the reason why we could play that song on Trent Radio is because the original version, the radio edited version, edited out the words F and U for some reason.
So it was just Seek Amy?
It was like, Seek Amy.
Oh my gosh. What's really funny? Yeah. This is so funny, our censorship stuff, because the song got edited out of the song, but the video is so risque.
Oh, totally.
Holy moly. It was like watching soft porn.
It was definitely soft porn.
I'm not usually a big Britney Spears fan, but I have to say that video it's actually kind of a good message.
Definitely. Look it up.
Yeah, I recommend watching it.
For sure.
It's basically juxtaposing this idea of being this like pretty housewife who like bakes a pie at the end. It's like, look, we have this perfect little family, and like a total slut, and I say that in a good way.
Definitely. So we're gonna talk now about the female orgasm? Or what do
you
want
to say? Okay. So there was like kind of a bit of stagnation. So you had like this idea that women had no sexuality, and then women got the vote, so at least they became their own property. So it started to come out a little bit. Mm-hmm. You started having like some women not get married. Oh my God, gasp. Oh,
goodness.
Start to live for themselves a little bit. But like, so there's so much to talk about, and I wonder how much we should save for other shows. But
yeah, definitely.
There was an interest. I'll mention it briefly. We can go into it more detail during our STD show. But during the wars, what happened with women's sexuality was when venereal disease, STDs, were spreading, mm-hmm. there was this concept that women were the disease. They were the only carriers.
Wow.
That men were not carriers. So there was all these like posters warning soldiers, because soldiers can't help themselves. They're men. They have to have sex. To not sleep with these women, essentially prostitutes or like sexual deviant women, mm-hmm. Because they could catch venereal disease. Wow. There was no education really directed towards women. It was all directed towards men. And also, the only way a woman could get venereal disease is to be having sex. Yeah. So therefore, she's worthless to society anyway, because she's not a real woman anymore.
Wow.
But the posters are very interesting because the women actually are labeled in a lot of these old posters as the disease. So like as chlamydia. So like if you were a woman who had chlamydia, you were not a woman with chlamydia. You were chlamydia.
Oh, chlamydia, the woman.
Yes. It's very interesting. Like like this whole notion of like, you know, if you're a woman and have sex, it's so bad that you are diseased.
Huh.
But if a man got venereal disease, it's like he was, you know, it wasn't his fault.
Yeah.
Because men are supposed to have sex. It's only the corrupted women that pass on the disease, because it's an evil that results from women being sexual.
That's unfortunate, because I mean, it still exists in our society in some ways today. Not that women do it, but gay men have been kind of targeted as that as well now, right?
So like only gay men can spread AIDS.
Oh my goodness.
Straight people don't get AIDS.
No, never.
Oh, it's satire.
Yes.
That was sarcasm.
That was a little sarcasm. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. We don't believe that. We're not idiots. Thank you. We're taking a look at a couple really interesting articles that Vazgina here shared with me earlier this week.
Yeah, because then what you had, after World War II, there was a lot more women working. Even with the whole like backlash during the 50s of the government and companies being like, no, stop working. We don't need you anymore. War's over. Too many women got a taste of freedom. And with that came the idea that they're sexual.
Oh.
So a ton of literature started to come out in the 60s and the 70s. And this is like the women's sexual revolution. And it was actually like a big time for revolutions on all sorts of levels. But for women, it was mostly reproductive and sexual. This was like when birth control happened. This is when all these papers came out arguing against this idea that the female orgasm was a myth. It was a long time it was supposed to be a myth. And then people were like, okay, well, they're, you know, maybe you can orgasm through your clitoris, but that's it. There's only one kind of orgasm.
The amount of women that had to go unsatisfied for it to be classified as a myth is like beyond mind-boggling to me. Like,
yeah.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, tons and tons and tons of literature came out in the 60s and 70s, like really famous articles now. And also magazines, like as much as I hate Cosmopolitan currently, mm-hmm. back then it was really liberating to talk about sex at all.
Yeah.
Chatelaine was another like big one.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, huge. Hmm. The editorials in Chatelaine were actually like super progressive. Even like ahead of their time, sometimes occasionally. Hmm. Very interesting stuff, actually, to like if you ever get your hands on like a 60s or 70s copy of like a Cosmo or Chatelaine or any of the older women like women's magazines, they're really, really interesting reads.
Huh.
It's such a like, I mean, now you look at a Cosmo and it's sex, 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 sex. Back then, they were like trying to justify why they would even talk about sex in their magazine.
Definitely. I mean, it takes more like a modern bust magazine to compare, I would assume.
Yeah, basically.
Wow.
So there's a really great website called, it's the Canadian Women's, oh man, shoot, what's it called? I have the acronym in front of me. It's CWLU, Her Story website. Miranda?
I would assume that it's Canadian Women's Liberation something, but I have no idea. So let's open up a thing. Hooray. Just so that you can look it up yourself. Yeah.
Chicago Women's Liberation Union. We see C and we're like, Canadian!
Chicago. Chicago's close enough. That's
yeah,
fine.
It's a Great Lake City.
Nice. So the article we're looking at right now is Sex or Hey, I Thought It Was Supposed to Be Fun. This was supposed to be fun. Uh-huh. There you go.
So the editor's note is that in February 1972 issue of Womankind, this author wrote about the contradictory feelings that many women have toward sex. So this is a 1972 article. So this is a long time ago.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because they have the person's name that wrote the article is actually just her first name. It doesn't have any sort of like connection, which is kind of ironic because that's exactly what we're doing right now on the radio. But for sure, it's a very interesting article.
So this is 40 years ago, and let's see how relevant it still is today. What's changed in 40 years? Okay. She writes, "One of the realities illuminated by the women's liberation movement has been the appalling lack of knowledge we as women have about our own bodies and how uncomfortable we often feel with them and in them. This is bound to have an effect on our having good sexual and sensual relationships. Heterosexual relationships provide a special problem because we are learning that relationships between the sexes have historically been unequal, more often than not oppressive to women, and clearly favoring men's sexuality and well-being. Ironically, the female body, while a source of real and fantasy pleasure to men, is often itself left frustrated, unpleased, and cold. Accepting the fact that heterosexual relationships will probably not change significantly for large numbers of women until the social and economic relationships between the sexes have been radically changed, perhaps it would be useful to consider a few of the things that block our having pleasurable relationships with men now." Wow. Today, in accord with the sexual revolution, I like that sound of that.
Yeah.
"It is more socially acceptable for women to enjoy sex. Some magazines encourage this notion to the point of assuming women should always love sex and have multiple orgasms every time. Mm. This idea has created some problems because though we are all in favor of women enjoying sex, it will take more than cheering articles in Cosmopolitan to make this possible. In the first place, this new attitude can become a new means of oppressing women. We all recognize that part in ourselves that lives up to what we expect, what is expected of us. It is a common psychological attitude of any group of people who is oppressed. So now, instead of being the good wife and mother, post-war through early 60s expectation, we have to be the sexually alive and enjoying it woman. The catch is that we weren't consulted as to our desires in either case. Particularly in the counterculture and youth movements, there's developed a new image of women which tends to look down on women who aren't eager to go to bed with every man who approaches them and don't enjoy sex a lot. How can we enjoy our own body just like that overnight? It isn't as though we are all potentially sexually eager and are just waiting for the social word to start enjoying ourselves. Centuries of definition have kept us from experiencing or admitting feeling guilty about being a poor wife and mother. We now feel guilty about not enjoying sex. We must learn about what is pleasurable to us at our own speed, with our own rhythms and our own terms. It's quite long article, mm-hmm. but I really recommend it because she goes on to say like a bunch of really interesting solutions and how you can get to know your own body and do what's right for you, not just what's expected for you of you.
Definitely. Definitely. I mean, that as you said, it's completely relevant to today in some regards.
Oh yeah, I feel like you could read that article as if it was written yesterday.
Oh, definitely. I agree. It's too bad that we don't have debate. We have lively debate on here. Mm-hmm. We actually have a message from one of our listeners, anonymous. It's really interesting to read it because it's in reference to what we're talking about earlier, the 19th century definition of sex and women's idea of sex. So this says, men have also been subject to their own societal pressures and expectations regarding sex throughout history. The idea of being a gentleman in the 19th century, which was ultimately a revival of older notions of chivalry, problematized what men could and could not do as acceptable behavior. Sex has posed problems for both sexes in every historical period.
So we really appreciate the comment.
Definitely.
But I need to make a little... I have a little bit of opinions around this thing. So early in the show, we did say that for another show, we will be talking about the history of men's sex drive, and that will be for another show because it is in itself a topic.
Definitely.
And we also definitely said that, you know, men had this stereotype that they always needed sex, so that, you know, we've acknowledged that, yes, men, and like the message said, too, it's spot on. Like, there's always been these societal pressures on men as well. But my experience of talking about women being oppressed sexually, mm-hmm. there hasn't been a single time I've talked about that publicly where a man has not said, yes, but men too.
Yeah, that's true.
So it's interesting. I'm not saying it's wrong or anything like that. I just think it's interesting. And maybe it's a sign that, you know, women do have a place to now, like, we have had sexual revolutions, we do get to talk about it a lot more. Men, I don't know how many men get to have these conversations, actually. Like, you don't hear about it as much. It's not,
it's true, you know. And you know what, it's unfortunate in our society in general, the fact that men, I've found more and more now that people know that I have a radio show that talks about sex, I get a lot more questions from my male counterparts in my life. Like, all my male friends have started asking me questions that they didn't feel were acceptable to ask people before, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so there is part of the idea that these questions are not, they're too taboo to even talk about. And even those men who are gentle and kind and the nice people that they are, they don't feel like they're comfortable in exploring what women want.
Yeah.
In their, if there's, you know, of course, in heterosexual relationships. And I mean, it's unfortunate. But also, women, as we were talking about, have long since suffered in reference to the idea that we are supposed to be specifically either really good or really bad and no in between.
Yeah. So we're going to play a song and then we'll get to the last two. We'll get to the like modern history of the women's female sex drive.
This song is modern as well. This is a good song. We're talking about sexy music videos. I need to continue to play sexy music videos, it seems, just to entertain us here in the sound booth.
Okay, I think it's funny that you call all our songs the good songs. Like, we're only gonna play crappy songs, so this one is a good one.
This is I am editing out all the crap that I have listened to this week. This is awesome, so enjoy it while you can.
I bet you there's a lot of people that probably hate this song.
Yes, Gina, are you saying
I like it. I like this song.
Good. The reason why this song is called Buttons by the Pussycat Dolls featuring Snoop Dogg. The reason why this song is relevant, I'm going to say that before we even play it, just because we like to get into more stuff later. It's relevant because the Pussycat Dolls were founded in Los Angeles, and the choreographer, Robin Anton, created this group in 1995, and they used to be a burlesque troupe. So they used to just be burlesque dancers, and then they decided, you know what, we can make a lot of money because some of us can sing. So this is Buttons by the Pussycat Dolls.
What it do, baby boy? Yeah, little mama, you looking good. I see you on the plate with a player from the hood. Come holler at me, you got it like that. Big Snoop Dogg with the lead pussycat. I show you how I go that. Yeah, I wanna throw that. Me and you, one-on-one, treat it like a show that. You look at me and I look at you. I'm reaching for your shirt, what you want me to do? I'ma show you where to put it at. PCD on me, yeah, I thought I saw a pussycat. Now roll with the big dog, all six of y'all on me. Now tell me how I feel, baby doll. Ashley, Nicole, Carmi, Jessica, Kimberly, Melody, you telling me?
Hot. Listen up. Yeah. I can't take this.
So that, as I said before, that was this is the Naughty Hour. That was Buttons by the Pussycat Dolls and Snoop Dogg.
So we got a bunch of messages from male listeners about men's sexuality. So what we're gonna do, because we are pressed for time, and because the theme of the show is supposed to be women's sexuality, next week we will discuss men's sexuality and sex drive and stereotypes and pressures men have faced. Because the messages we got are fabulous. They're definitely really insightful. They're really the men who sent them are like really opening up.
And we are gonna actually, I've just sent myself a Facebook message so that we can read exactly what you said. So tune in next week while we read your comments, because they're definitely really important. We don't want to miss out on them.
We just want to like give this show the space to women, and next show we will give the space to men.
Definitely.
And maybe another show we'll have both in one show.
Or we can do transgender. We can do all the things.
Oh, yes, because there's a whole, that's a whole other.
Yeah, I know.
There are so many things.
I know. There's too many things to talk about. That's why we did this show. Okay. So we're going to read a message that we did get from one of our former guest stars.
JB.
So JB says, I missed the first part of the show. So I don't know if you touched on this. We didn't. So another thing to consider about female sexuality is the Christian culture. Often girls and boys are taught to wait to have sex until they're married. And my experience has evoked fear and guilt in me. But in some cases, people struggle with their married sex lives because women suddenly are told it's okay to have sex. But how do you jump from 0 to 60?
So this definitely ties in with the like Victorian concept of women as pure. Mm-hmm. A lot of that was tied into Christian values, but again, that's also a whole other show with religion and sexuality.
It's true. We should totally do that too. Wow. I need to write these all down.
But right now we're trying to discuss the history of women's sexual desire in Western countries.
Definitely.
So this idea first was that women were asexual. Mm-hmm. They had no sexuality. And that they only, their sexuality was there to serve men's needs and for reproduction. Then we had this idea that, well, women should have some sexuality, enough to at least serve their men's needs. So if you're not feeling sexual, then you were classified as frigid. And this was a medical term. There's something wrong with you for not wanting to have sex with someone you didn't even want to marry in the first place. And then this sexual revolution happened, we're like, no, like the female orgasm is not a myth. We like to have sex. We want to have sex. All this literature came out around it. But and the birth control movement happened. But there's since that happened in the 70s, there's still been some figuring out with it. Mm-hmm. And so these two things that have happened, and these are the exact same things that kind of existed back in the 19th century. And it's that if you are a sexual woman and you're trying to own your sexuality, two things can be kind of forced upon you by other women, more so by other women than men, actually, at this point. You are being objectified. Say you want to be a porn star. Say you really want to do that. People will just say, no, you're victimized. Yeah. Somewhere along the line, you felt objectified or oppressed. You're not really wanting to be a porn star. You're being exploited.
Yeah, because your father didn't love you or whatever.
You couldn't possibly, you couldn't possibly just want to do it for yourself. Same with anyone who's promiscuous. The other thing is there's still a lot of slut shaming that happens. There's still a lot of this view that like if you're a sexual woman, you're a slut.
Definitely.
So you have to be sexual and liberated, but only to a certain extent. Because if you go too far, you, again, lose this identity of being a whole woman. You're now a victim or you're a slut. So this revolution is now, I think, currently in a new phase where women are like trying to really, really say, no, I can be sexual and I can be empowered, and it doesn't have to be a separation. Like we talked about Beyonce a few shows ago. Mm-hmm. Didn't we?
Yeah, I'm sure we did. Yeah. I talk about Beyonce all the time.
I think we did. There was this thing on Facebook about her recent outfit and how she should no longer she should no longer be a role model because she's being too sexual and it's a bad message for little girls. Okay. Any man that is sexual in a business profession, he still gets to be respected as a businessman.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at any like actor, male actor, they're not saying, oh, he's a bad role model because he has a shirt off in a movie.
Because it's expected of men, unfortunately.
But like Beyonce should be able to be sexual and be a powerful businesswoman and be a mother and be a wife. Mm-hmm. Like she doesn't lose all those credentials because she wore a risque outfit.
No, definitely. And it wasn't even that risque. If you look it up, it's essentially her wearing an entire outfit that looked like she was naked, but she had sparkles instead.
So that's slut shaming. It's saying that, oh, because we think you've gone too far with your sexuality, all of your other achievements don't count anymore.
Definitely.
Now you're just a slut. So something that came out of that is this idea, which is so similar to seduction laws and rape laws way back in the 19th century, that men, for some reason, and this is so false and we'll discuss it next show, cannot control themselves. And therefore, if you're wearing a risky outfit, mm-hmm. it's not their fault if they rape you. Because, you know, watch what you're wearing. That the men couldn't possibly control themselves, which is horrible to A, put that stereotype on men, but to B, make it like it's, you know, like women have any control of who, of when they get raped.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it doesn't. Yeah. Okay, I'm not even going into that because that's forever long.
So what came out of that is this thing called the slut walk, where a ton of women, it spread all over North America, over worldwide, actually.
I'm pretty sure worldwide. Yeah.
We're like, no, we can wear whatever we want. It doesn't give anyone the right to rape us. Like, you want us to look sexual. It's in all the magazines. It's in all the media. But then when we do that, we're told it's our fault if people touch us without consent. Like, no. Like, you gotta, like, that's not okay. So then they had all these big walks where women dressed slutty,
quote unquote,
and said, I'm a slut and that's my choice, but it doesn't mean you can take my consent away from me.
Definitely.
So you have stuff like that happening right now.
We've gone from like the 19th century to today. Wow.
It's like, it's like the still the same concept. It's just happening on a different level, a different scale. Now, like, you know, back then, and you were a slut if you had sex with one person outside of marriage. Now you're a slut if you have sex with five people outside of marriage. You know, it's like, hasn't jumped that much.
Yeah, for sure. It's very strange the way that that's kind of, it's transversed into today's state.
Yeah.
We actually got another message, by the way, and I just want to read it. There's, oh my goodness, there's so many messages. We're so popular. Thank you so much for listening, first and foremost. The message from Anonymous is, what about female historical figures who are very sexual? I'm thinking Cleopatra, Marilyn Monroe, et cetera, et cetera. True. That's all I can say. We don't have too much time to go into it, but definitely very true. An intelligent man sent us a message. Should we save this one for later? Or we shouldn't do it now. We can do it now. It's in relation to both of the things. So this is a male celebrity who got in trouble for being sexual, Tiger Woods. Female celebrity who didn't get in trouble for being sexual, Kristen Stewart.
So Tiger Woods didn't get in trouble for being sexual. Tiger Woods got in trouble because he promoted and branded this image of himself as a family man.
Yeah.
That's what happened. Like, if he hadn't done that, because there are plenty, plenty of celebrity athletes that are just like, yeah, I like sex, and they still get, they don't have their reputations knocked. It wasn't about sex with Tiger Woods. It was that he branded himself as having a wholesome brand, and like that was his thing, and then he was a liar.
Definitely.
It was a charade, so people felt betrayed because he had lied. So it's a little different. And as far as Kristen Stewart, she did get in trouble for being sexual. The tabloids were all over her, and the only reason, and then when the she and Rob, who, that's his name, Rob Patterson, what the hell is his name, when they got back together, it was like, oh, he took her back. How great of him to take this cheating slut back.
She was, everyone was hating on. I can't say that she didn't get in trouble from, maybe not mainstream media, but she got in trouble by the fans. Unbelievable amount, for sure, because everyone's like, oh, well, she doesn't deserve this fellow. Like, he's beautiful, so obviously she can't do that to him. So yeah, interesting message for sure, and I like that you're talking to us, so thank you for that.
And historical figures who are very sexual, the reason why we're doing this in modern times, like Cleopatra, yes, powerful woman. Marilyn Monroe, she's seen as a sex icon. Nobody talks about how, what an amazing businesswoman she was.
Definitely.
No one talks about how great she was with marketing herself and creating her brand. Nobody talks like that about her.
No.
She's a sex symbol.
Definitely.
So all of this ramping up to our final conclusion. So there's still this concept that men have higher sex drives than women. Even on WebMD, they state that one of the reasons why women could have trouble with their sexuality and sexual desire is genetics.
Ooh,
which
genetics.
Is just drives me crazy. It says, this is what it says on WebMD, which people go to for like medical information.
Definitely.
Men have every incentive to have sex to pass along their genetic material. By contrast, women may be hardwired to choose their partners carefully because they are the ones who can get pregnant and wind up taking care of the baby. They are likely to be more attuned to relationship quality because they want a partner who will stay around to take care of the child. They're also more likely to choose a man with resources because of his greater ability to support a child. Okay, this has been debated scholarly on like very high academic levels by like scientists, biologists, geneticists, historians. It's like, it's not true. It's a total myth. First of all, they have no way of proving like you know when you hear like how many like genetic studies you would have to do? You would have to do like thousands of people based off of like hundreds of cultures to determine any of this to be relevant. Second of all, some people will say, oh, but look at the animal world. Yeah, it's like completely all over the place.
Definitely. The animal world does, I mean, exist different for every single species.
Yeah. That's just even amongst primates.
Yeah, definitely.
It's different. Mm-hmm. So there is no evidence. Also, I don't think it's really fair to compare like humans to cows. It's like, really? There's a big intelligence culturally, especially shift there.
Yeah. Definitely.
The other thing is you actually have some geneticists have come out and said, well, no, there's more proof it's the opposite. Because genetically, it doesn't make sense to put all your eggs in one basket. You wouldn't want to just pick one man because you actually strengthen the chance of your child surviving to have a mixed gene pool, to have a variety. You have lots of kids and with lots of different donors, sperm donors, basically, because that increases the chance of some of your offspring being alive. So genetically, it makes more sense to be promiscuous.
Good to know. I'm going to go do that right now.
Brings us to our last article.
Definitely. Our last article is called The Myth of the Vaginal Orgasm.
No, it's not.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh,
change
no,
it
where
up.
Where is it?
Where is the last article?
It's way back in our... Oh, shoot. I thought we had it up.
We did not
It's
have
way
it
back
up.
In our things from last week.
Oh, my goodness.
The gist of the article is this huge study came out. They did a big study involving sexologists and scientists and all sorts of...
Sorry, she's pointing. This is continue talking.
No, up more.
Up, down.
You know, it's a news story. Up, up, down.
Up,
slower, lower.
This is exactly
up.
How she
oh,
likes
up
it.
A little more. A little more. A little more.
Okay.
Right there.
Okay. This article is called "Turns Out Women Have Really, Really Strong Sex Drives. Can Men Handle It?"
A new book questions the conventional wisdom about female desire.
Ooh. So, since we have only 2 minutes left, could you summarize?
Yes, the summary of it is basically saying that it turns out women want just as much sex as men do, and this drive is not, for the most part, sparked or sustained by emotional intimacy and safety. When it comes to the craving for sexual variety, the research suggests that women may be even less well-suited for monogamy than men.
Hmm.
The author, the journalist who put this together and worked with like scientists, his name is Daniel Bergner, and he says Bergner's work puts what may be the last nail in the coffin of the old consensus that women use sex as a means to get something else they really want, such as enduring monogamous emotional intimacy and the goods and safety that come in marriage, with a protector and provider. In her review, Solon's normally hyperbole adverse Tracy Clark Flory was beside herself. This book should be read by every woman on earth, she writes. The implications are huge. So the idea is that science is finally asking the right questions about what women want, perhaps because enough of us are ready to hear the answer. So it's basically just saying, like, women are as horny or hornier than men.
Yep.
However, this isn't enough to guarantee equality, is also what it says. And also that a lot of the men's reaction to this book was quite negative. There was a lot of there's a lot of men came out saying, no, this isn't true, because I have personal examples of like men's libidos are still higher. So it's interesting. There's like and some women, too, are coming out and saying, well, I don't know if this speaks to me. But most women, the majority of people who've commented on this book are saying, oh my God, yes, thank God someone actually has a scientific studies showing that this is a thing.
Wow.
So we've gone from women are asexual to women may possibly have higher sex drives than men.
Wow. And, go ahead.
Oh, the name of the book, just in case people want to look it up.
The name of the book is...
The name of the book.
Woohoo. I can't click the right.